The only people I ever hear saying like, that's going to kill are usually people who've never done comedy live.
Yeah, and they have not felt the unbelievable sting of a silent audience. Hi there, I'm Melissa McCarthy.
Hi, I'm Ben Falcone, director of Thunder Force, and also I'm Melissa's husband.
And this is The Long Take.
Crab, we got a situation here.
Handle it, Kenny.
Good day, mate.
What do you remember about the origins of this film, Mooch? Because I remember the origin quite well, but I want to hear your take on it, if our memories are the same. Because we're now getting old-ish, we have chairs that we like, and we were on our chairs, and I handed you a scotch. I basically had the loose version of it, and I started with Emily and Lydia. At that point, those characters were named Octavia and Melissa.
Subtle.
Because we knew we wanted Octavia to do it from jump. And I pitched it to you starting as kids, and I remember the thing that you liked about it was the relationships. And, you know, the idea that we could do a really cool superhero movie, but, you know, with a heart.
Well, I think it's why Octavia and I both love doing it, because it's not just a rock'em sock'em thing. There's so much action in it, and the action's amazing because you know how much I love that. It's also so much about that friendship, and it's also, I mean, everybody has that friend. Everybody has a friend that you've had for a long time. You've gone up, you've gone down. But there is still that connection, and you're better off with that person.
I don't have an appointment, but I'm Lydia Berman. I'm her best friend, so we're not currently what I would say best friends or friends. Estranged, I think, puts a stink on it that it might not warrant.
Even if they drive you crazy sometimes, you're still better off. That person gives you some kind of balance. And I also just really love that her life's goal, it wasn't revenge, which I think could have been really easy to go to.
It's not fair your parents got iced by some miscreants and now we're stuck with you.
Instead, it was to build herself up strong enough to fight back and help other people.
Even if someone is justifiably seeking vengeance, really then their motivation is to be a murderer. And it's hard to make a comedy with someone who loves to murder.
It's hard to root for that. And it's so funny to, Octavia's one of the best actresses on the planet. That's just a fact. We know this. And to watch her, how she prepares for something that, like, how that character suited her, or maybe she just makes every character suit her, I thought was so great, because it wasn't making someone a superhero that didn't have to come in and be all bluster and all this, and her power was her mind and her goodwill, and that's just a take that I haven't really seen.
Wow. My heart's really racing.
Oh boy.
Now that we're going into a possible...
What is your criteria for choosing a film or a role?
I think it's got to be a great story to tell. I think it has to be relevant for why we're telling it. And I have to kind of love the character.
Now we're officially friends. Bet your ass we are.
I think on the outer shell, I'm drawn to characters that are maybe not typically likable. And then what I really love is to try to kind of show the crusty outer shell versus kind of like the soft, chewy center. And I think that's a fun balance when you kind of think, I don't know why I like this person, but I do.
Yeah, when people would say, oh, Lee Israel, she's such a villain. And you were always like, I like her.
Like, she was so good at what she did. I tend to fall in love with all of my characters for different reasons. So.
As do I. I love all your characters.
You don't say 1985 the Chicago Bears. You say 1985, the Chicago Bears won the Super Bowl and created one of the best albums/singles ever, which was the Super Bowl Shovel.
Carol Burnett was a huge thing in our house, and it really was big for me. One, I remember thinking, like, that's her show. She's generating this. I love that she absolutely had no problem being such the butt of the joke.
Oh boy, I haven't really driven this one.
How can you have it not drive it?
Getting in that slowly on purpose?
Oh boy, that's intimidating.
I think there's something so magical about that. It was the same with Gilda Radner and Jane Curtin, Madeline Kahn, all of those actresses. I just always thought there's something really amazing about being like, I don't care if I'm a fool. For a long time, it's like women were always supposed to be like, you know, perfectly done and they're charming and they say the right thing and blah, blah, blah. So to watch some of these kind of disruptive women come in and just be like, I'm going to do and say and look however I feel the character is. I was like, ooh, it was like a juicy morsel.
You look good.
Oh. What was it like working with Octavia on set and as an actor?
Octavia is, as a person, constantly present. She is so connected to you. She picks up on every little thing. Zig that way, she'll go right with you. She'll come back. It's less about what you're doing and how much you are kind of there for your acting partner. And she probably does that perfectly. And she's such a super preparer. I mean, she's the first on set. She's, you know, weeks ahead on our lines. She's just all that work so she can come in and have it look so effortless.
This is amazing.
I'm about to get through a wall.
This was a really different movie for us to do scale-wise and like the technical aspect of it. Was that daunting going into it? Because all of a sudden we are in a whole new world. Like, yes, we always love stunts. These stunts were on steroids for us. Yes, we've done CGI, but like this was all so much bigger. Like, how did that feel for you going into that?
I was excited. You know, I thought that if we prepared enough that, you know, other people have done it. Our friend, the producer, Rob Cowan, did it with Aquaman. I figured, you know, and all these other people, I figured if we had enough help, I mean, the amount of preparation you need is enormous. So I think the fact that we knew what we didn't know and we were willing to learn and, you know, continue to be educated as filmmakers. And because if you're not continuing to learn, you're dying, right? So I thought it was sort of invigorating. To take the challenge, though, yes, I was, of course, because I'm a card-carrying coward, I was nervous about it.
I think that's so important, though. I don't think most people ever want to just say, like, oh, there's so many parts of this I don't know, but I'm going to figure it out, and then you're willing to go to the people that are, I mean, there's so many specialties and so many technicians, and especially stuff with technology now. You have to be open and be like, I have no idea. How do you make Octavia invisible? I really feel like it's also never one department. It's like, it can't be all stunts. It can't be all visual effects. It can't be all special effects.
Yeah, to me, it was a blast to do. And, you know, to really synchronize the stunt department with the visual effects department is like such an exciting, and the special effects department. So you've got real special effects with real stunts that then morph into a visual effect that go back to the stunt. It just needs a lot of preparation. And, you know, we've learned so much.
I have to say, as an actor, I hope we never could be like, we don't really need you at all. We can just do a digi-double. Like, I'm like, I hope not. But it takes all those departments that have to absolutely see the same goal, work towards it, and like everybody, it's part of the fun of it. Like, you have to build the same thing on so many layers to have them be able to stack on top of each other. And then you're like, oh, that's it. But it takes just so many people and so many brains to get it there.
How would you describe how we work together? What is our process?
Well, I think most people know we've met at the Groundlings Theater, and you know, you'd go and write with people, you'd write at the theater, you'd meet and have like coffee and write. And I don't think either one of us has a very big ego, because if you would say yellow and I was like, oh, what about blue? Then we'd be like, oh, purple. Like, we could just kind of keep adding layers onto it. And it was never like, well, I want this and you want that. And, you know, we'll never meet in the middle. I think we've always had more middle.
Do you maybe want to hang out after school?
Sure.
What do you like to do?
Read.
Oh, you weren't kidding.
I also think we're constantly ever-changing. Like, we work so hard on scripts and then also throw it all away kind of without a second thought. I mean, does that ever drive you crazy?
No, because we always get what we work so hard on for months and months and possibly years. And then finally you're there and you get it. But, you know, we learned that on Tammy, right? That if you have a good actor who's prepared and the camera's in focus and you're doing the camera the way you want to do it and it's lit well, and then you say it, you know, a couple times with a couple different intentions, you might as well get new things.
I think we get what we want and then be like, let's also get this.
Ah! I hope that's your knee. I got pancake in all the wrong places.
You just don't know what's going to work and what's not going to work until you put it all together, right?
That's for sure. We both produce in whatever the full sense of that word is. Everybody's opinions kind of get put in. And if you're directing, I can't say like, oh, what if we track this shot around and move with her?
I think it's still nice seeing people like getting into it. Maybe somebody throws him the bag and he goes for something.
It always feels fun, like a new fun idea, as opposed to like, why didn't you like what I just did? Like, we've never ever done that with each other.
That probably goes back to being on stage at Groundlings, right? And having, you know, we've worked with Kristen Wiig and Maya Rudolph and, you know, Jordan Black and Damon Jones and just all these incredible people. These are the funniest people we know. All of them at different times had the sketch that they thought was the one, and it just stopped on stage like a dead fish. And you're like, so that means you have to have humility, right? Because if you have any, the only people I ever hear saying like, that's gonna kill are usually people who've never done comedy live.
Yeah, and they have not felt the unbelievable sting of a silent audience.
We screen our films and we see how people actually react to it. So, you know, we're usually very happy to have a couple different versions of each, you know, comedic beat.
The crab, what's his power? Like tasting delicious with melted butter?
It's just so subjective. Your favorite joke in a movie, and sometimes there's ones where I'm like, I love it with my whole heart. I truly, well, I think it's the funniest thing in the movie, but nobody in an audience goes for it. And you can't deny that when no one else seems to like it. There's always mixed ones, because you tell one joke to 100 people, 20 don't get it, 20 are offended, 20 miss the point. You know, it's always different. Like, everybody's humor is different. But when no one goes for it, you can't say like, the audience didn't get it. You have to be like, God, I love it, but it didn't play. And those are always heartbreakers.
Do not throw that bus. I can't hear you because I'm literally throwing a bus.
I'm throwing styrofoam. It's not very heavy at all.